Dan.
And I'm Gaz.
And welcome to episode 13 of Flickchat.
This, unfortunately, boys and girls, is the last week of Wilson month.
No!
We've had quite a nice bit of feedback for our choice of theme month. Some people have liked the idea we focused on Owen Wilson, the greatest comedy actor in the history of the world, but yet others have hated the fact we've devoted 4 weeks to this dribbling pile of cack. We were scheduled to review Marley and Me, but we couldn't watch it again, because let's face it, if you didn't cry watching Marley and Me, you had no soul.
A crushed soul.
I had no soul after watching this film.
I actually hoped that Owen Wilson would wake up, Patrick Duffy would be in the shower, and it would all have been a dream. But no, it wasn't a dream.
Monkeys cry.
But anyway,
let's get on with this week's film. So, we thought we'd not end on a low note, let's end it on a high note!
Yeah!
So we decided to do Bottle Rocket, which was Owen Wilson's first film, and a bit of a writing jive as well. So, what's it about?
This film follows the story of Anthony, played by Owen's brother Luke, as he leaves a mental institution on his own free will, I might add, after a nervous breakdown. Upon reuniting with his best friend and partner in crime, Digman, they go on a petty crime spree which involves robbing houses and basically just being gits. This is an attempt to reunite with Digman's former employee,
Mr. Hendrick,
as they look at leading a life of crime. But all is not well, as most films would dictate. With Bob, their best friend, as the getaway driver, they pull off a relatively big heist of a bookstore, but this is where it goes wrong, as they have to go out on the run, and they end up in a crappy little motel on the outskirts of town.
That's pretty much it, isn't it?
Yeah. Luke finds love in the shape of the maid and foreign woman, Inez. He falls in love, he decides he wants to spend the rest of his life with her, but then they have to move on as Bob flees because his brother gets in trouble. They go head back to town, get employed again by
Mr. Henry,
which sets up for the biggest heist
in the world.
Will it go right? Will it not? Who knows?
Well, this film. 2 weeks ago, we did Behind Enemy Lines. I thought, wow, that film was bad. I thought, Owen Wilson, you cannot get any lower. I was wrong. Rocket wrong. This film was bloody awful. I watched this film because I thought, because we, as we said before, we were going to do Marley and Me. And we do like that film. We think it is a good film. But we thought, let's not end it on a low note because it's a bit of, it's meant to be Owen Wilson month. It's meant to be fun. It's meant to be great.
A madcap.
Exactly. But this, we watched the trailer and I grinned from ear to ear and I thought, this film looks perfect. It just looks like a stupid, like, mad caper of a film. So I thought, this could be interesting. So, it was Sunday afternoon, I put the film on. Half an hour went by, it felt like an hour. An hour went by, it felt like two. By the end of it, I wanted to put rusty razor blades up my
ass.
This to me was the prime cut of dog tripe. The characters are so boring. They are just boring. They make themselves out to be these funny guys because, oh, we do petty crime heists and, oh, we're trying really hard. I didn't give two monkey towers of a block about what they were doing because they were so dull. Owen Wilson wasn't Owen Wilson. Do you see the connection here? He had short hair. When he has short hair, he can't do anything to save his life. I mean, the only interesting thing I got out of this film was the fact that Owen Wilson is credited as Owen C. Wilson. That's the only thing that interested me about this film. And the only funny bit in this film, for me, was the bit when he gets punched in the face in a bar. That was it. There was no laughter for me in this film. I was just sat there thinking, when is this going to end? When is this piece of crap going to end? It, to me, it felt, I mean, I don't think it was meant to be, but it did feel quite pretentious to me as well. It felt like it was, oh, I'm an indie film. I'm going to make a film about people on a madcap caper. It's on a low budget. But we've got James Caan in there, so that might save us. James Caan doesn't save many films. I don't think he actually saves any films, in all honesty. No. So putting James Caan in a film just makes me think, yeah, this film is going to be awful, and they've just cast him to make the film any better than the dog tripe that it is. I mean, I've said some bad things in my time about films, but I can't make this review any shorter than what I could make it. So I'm going to stop here, because I'm just going to go on and on and on about how awful it is. I know I'm saying much about the story, but you've heard the story. It's quite a bland and predictable story. Yeah, he falls in love, whoop-de-doo. They get on their caper, whoop-de-doo. Their capers go wrong, whoop-de-doo. I was expecting that. Mr. Henry's an asshole, whoop-de-doo. So all in all, this film is a from me. And that's my two cents.
So where you wanted mad crap, you got bad crap.
Exactly. It's a bad crap of a caper. Not even a caper. It's more of a dragging me to hell. Although Drag Me to Hell was a lot better. This film was just dragging me to the pits of bloody hell. Go on, I'm
pits
done.
Pits of bloody hell.
I'm done now.
While it was played at test screenings, it scored the lowest points of any test screening in Columbia's history at the time. But yet it actually went on to be one of Martin Scorsese's top 10 films of that decade, which I thought was interesting.
He clearly has no taste.
Well, I don't know.
That's all I'm going to say.
I wasn't sure what to make of the movie. I mean, did they want it to be a comedy? Did they want it to be a drama? I wasn't really sure. There was a little bit to it where there was a slight glimmer of amusement, but there was nothing real to write home about. I thought as far as the pacing went in this film, it got to about 25 minutes in and it dragged. But I think once you hit the middle of the movie and they're reunited with
Mr. Henry,
it seemed to pick up a little bit and it got a little bit more sort of madcap and a little slightly more amusing than it was. I don't really know what to say. It's one of them films, I think, in order to formulate an opinion, you'd have to watch it for yourself. I'm hoping you do watch it so you can either say, I enjoyed it because it was slightly different to other indie films I've seen, or you can watch it and say, I agree, I did think it was a big pile of
ass.
But I don't think it was as predictable as made out. The fact that I really didn't see, from the ending point of view, and from what I thought was a total switch of roles, I didn't see that coming, I'll be honest. I might just because I'm not very clever, but I didn't see it coming. The people in it were as good as could be expected from a film of this calibre. Owen Wilson was very, as far as his acting goes in this, I thought he was very, very naive. He actually, after the film bombed at the box office, it just about recuperated the $7 million budget. He actually seriously considered joining the Marines because he thought there was no future in acting. I mean, can you imagine if he had joined the Marines?
He would have been behind enemy lines all over again.
Exactly, we probably would have had bloody Matthew McConaughey and Marley and me. And probably would have had Jack Black as the voice of Lightning McQueen.
That's not so bad.
Oh, I don't know. That would have been bloody terrible.
Oh, my God.
Cage, come here! I want you!
What? God!
I'm going to give this film, I think, a 3 out of 5. I'm not going to be really, really mean to it because I like Owen and I like Luke and I like the work. And the relationship between the three main characters, Digman, Anthony and Bob, I like the chemistry that they had because you got the impression they'd been friends since they were kids and the relationships between the three didn't look forced. I thought they looked very, very natural, and the way that they put the crew together and just little things like that, I thought it was quite cute, and it didn't feel forced and it didn't look too fake. So it wasn't the most enjoyable film I've ever watched, and I'll probably never watch the film again. But I wouldn't say it was as bad as some people made it out to be. So I'm going to give it a 3 out of 5.
Owen Wilson, you're credited as Owen C. Wilson in this. That was it for me. Nothing enjoyable from this film, in my opinion. So, once again, as was the case with Behind Enemy Lines, it's going to be a fat zero for me. Purely, script was crap, film was crap, and James Caan, you really can't save any films. So, that's it for me. That film was just awful. I will never watch that film again. I think they should have shown this in the torture scenes in Clockwork Orange. When they got them strapped to the chair and their eyes.
Like the fact that the Clockwork Orange was in the '70s and this was in 1996. Yep. They haven't got a time machine as well as a torture chair.
They could have got a DeLorean.
Yeah, but that was in the '80s. You just ballsing things up.
Yeah, they could have got a DeLorean, sent it back. Trust me. Uh-huh. DeLorean's still being made. Uh-huh. But anyway, that's it for Wilson Month. We hope you've enjoyed these 4 weeks of Wilson joy. I didn't enjoy two of them, but there you go. So that's it for our theme. Next week it's back to normal with all different films every week. So we hope you continue to watch and we will see you next week for episode 14.
Ta-da.
Yes?
No, I just had short hair.